quantum computing, but I am going to talk about quantum simulations and their value. And there's a lot of people that are working with me, that have worked with me. Some of them became professors. And there is a lot of good things that I have to say about them, but time is limited. So today I'll not do what I usually do. I will not give you the sales pitch, but rather start the discussion. So these are some thoughts about experiments in physics. This is where I want to start. About a month ago, we held at the Technion a special workshop for the honor of those that won the recent Wolf Prize, which was on quantum simulation and quantum optics, Peter Zoller and Ignacio Sirac. In that evening, we had a discussion, panel discussion. Now, usually panel discussions in the evening, people go home or fall asleep. But that one was actually prompted, and we designed it carefully. And because I was the organizer, I didn't want to instruct it, so I asked my good friend Michael Berry to do it. But I cooked the questions. Dorit was in the audience, and Bill Phillips, and Ignacio, and Peter were in the audience. Not in the panel. And Elena Speer was sitting more or less next to me. So I made sure that there are some provocative thoughts. So some of these thoughts are the outcome of that, but some of that have existed before that, and these are the first sentences are a discussion, result of a discussion of 10 years between Michael Berry and me, and very many arguments. So we'll see. Let's see how you respond to this. So experiments in physics. So the baseline is that physics is an experimental science. I think this is unquestionable, that physics is not a theoretical science. Rather, it's an experimental science. In other words, we explore things that we wish to understand. We wish to know the world. And the world exists there, whether we are here to measure it or not. And even that is a bit provocative. Okay? So starting with this, is that I would classify experiments in physics in three categories. There is the one that when you start an experiment or you go to do an experiment, you have no clue what's going on. Many discoveries in physics were done this way. One of them, one example is the ICC superconductivity. There's no solid theory to this day. Some people may claim otherwise, but I would not believe them. There are many, many, many other examples, but generally, to this day, there are, you know, when you look back, there are many examples. Superfluidity, superconductivity were discovered in experiment. And it took many years, sometimes 5 decades, to come up with a theory. So this is number one. Many of us would like to be in that slot. Quantum is not in that slot today at all. Okay. Second one is experiments that follow. You have a model, but it's incomputable. There are many examples. One of them, the most famous one to this crowd, is the Bose-Abbott model for more than 20, 30, give or take. Well, the vision is to do quantum simulations. This is the vision. Because in many cases, you know, quantum simulation is a simulation of a model. But nobody guarantees that Bose-Abbott is really what is happening in solid-state physics. Actually, there are many people, I would say some of them very senior and Nobel laureates, that think exactly otherwise. But there is a model there. And since you cannot tell today, you cannot compute the results of the model more than, I think Wikipedia told me that it's about 20. Maybe now it's 30. But it's really not very, very interesting to have such a small number of particles. And the interest starts on the order of thousands, where you can have condensates, let's say. So this is something that you know, we would like to know the answer. We can't compute these classical computers. So we do experiments. And the vision that started by Feynman and later on by many good people is to look at the experiment, to set up the initial conditions, look at the experiment, and take the outcome of many, many experiments as if this solves, I would say, in an analog way of computing, the problem, the model. It does not mean it reflects reality, but at the very least, we have an idea of the model. The third one is experiments that follow a model whose results are known. Almost everything that is done to this day in what people call quantum simulation sits right here, almost everything. There is an exception, for example, the Mott insulator transition that Immanuel Bloch did. But now, even that, I suspect that they had too few particles. So even that, I think that they could also compute. But let's give them the credit on that. Most of them are really doing either Gross-Pitayevsky, which in nonlinear optics we would call, then cubic nonlinear Schrödinger equation. And we know how to handle it. We know how to solve it. And there are many, many some interesting issues that have to do with it. But it's really not a real quantum phenomenon. If you accept wave-particle duality, this is where it ends. In other words, it is, like Elena Speck calls, the first generation of quantum discoveries. Once you accept, in other words, there's no entanglement needed. And this, most of the experiments today in quantum simulation are right here, right on that. And that, we optics people have experience of 20 years before that, almost everything. So people like to show very, very nice experiments in vortex solitons or discrete solitons in cold atoms. But we've done it 10 years before, including the theory. So there are many things. Now the question is, why do this kind of experiments? Why? In other words, why do experiments where you can calculate? If you cannot do it analytically, you can do a simple simulation. Simulation is hard. Improve your simulation. It's still computable. Why do it at all? And there is a very good answer to that. The first one is the first starting point. The physics is an experimental science. And experiments always lead to new ideas and often to new surprises. Even so, in other words, once you do an experiment, you get intuition that in numerics you cannot get. And that will lead you to new ideas that have not been explored. What I'm going to do now in the next hour or so is to give you some examples where we started from something known and we ended up in completely unknown territory. So, but I want to establish first something. So mind you, I will start with describing a Gedanken experimental system, and then I will show you experiments on that. So we call it spatial photonics. Okay, consider a monochromatic beam of light propagating in along some preferential axis, let's call it Z, in some bulk medium. Okay? So you have a beam in X and Y and propagates along Z. So if you look at, if it's monochromatic, in other words, time harmonic field, you can describe it like this. Let's suppose that everything is linearly polarized, okay? So now what you have, you separate the beam into some envelope riding on a plane wave along the Z direction, which is Z is chosen arbitrarily as the center of symmetry or the optical axis, okay? So doing some approximation that we in optics call the paraxial approximation or the slowly varying amplitude approximation, you end up with an equation that looks like this. And you look at the equation, and it reminds you something. It has the same mathematical structure as the Schrödinger equation, exactly one-to-one, okay? There are two differences that are important and fundamental. First one is that the evolution in quantum is evolution in time. We already sacrificed the time domain. There is nothing changes in time here. Everything is time harmonic. So evolution we have in the Z direction, only in Z. So we map time into Z, okay? The second one is that here the momentum could be in 1D, 2D, or 3D. Here in the spatial photonics, we have momentum in X and Y only. Z is already used. That has implications because many effects, linear and nonlinear, have to do with dimensionality. I'll give you an example in a few minutes on Anderson localization, where in 1D and 2D, you have a crossover but not a phase transition. In 3D, supposedly, you have a phase transition. Okay? So this is an important difference. That means that there are some things that we can observe, some things that we cannot observe. The last one, the other one, is the potential here in Schrödinger is mapped onto a local change in the refractive index in optics. Now, it has a negative sign because the potential well for electromagnetic waves is a region of higher refractive index, like an optical fiber. You know, it's made of glass, refractive index 1.5, give or take. So it is higher than air. So that's why it is able to guide the light, like in a potential well in quantum mechanics. And this is how optical communication came about. Okay, so that's the idea. So with this kind of system, this is what I'm going to show you today, what we can do and how we started where we know the results of a theory and we went after first observation just to understand what's going on because we knew that there will be many interesting new ideas, some of them unobserved to this day, or unexplained, I would say. Okay, so I will start with saying a few things on Anderson localization of light. Then I'll go back to the first slide and talk again about why do experiments and show you where we are headed, more or less what we did since then. Then I'll talk about localization under nonlinearity and disorder. That means that under interactions, in other words, attractive or repulsive. Then I'll talk about a new effect that we discovered 2 years ago about stochastic acceleration of wave packets. This is something that nobody observed, nobody predicted. We started it in experiments, and because I didn't believe it, we went to numerics, and then we came up with a model, and the model is not satisfactory. It is a Newtonian model because right now, only these very days, we are putting together a waves model. The Newtonian model can predict only so much, but not more. And then after that, I'll talk about something more recent that is relevant to this crowd as well. It has to do with photonic topological insulators. For those of you that don't follow that area, topological insulators are a new state of matter. Some people think this way, at least. Discovered in 2005 in condensed matter physics by Kane and Mealy, theoretically, and observed experimentally within 2 years in 1D and in 3D. In 2D and in 3D, and what they are is think about a piece of material that is at least 2D. The bulk is completely insulating, and there is current or there is transport only along the edge. The transport is fully topologically protected. That means that it's scatter free. If you look at transport or current along the edge, it cannot scatter back and it cannot scatter into the bulk. This was discovered in Onnes metaphysics, and the underlying reason behind that, why it's working because of fermionic property called Cramer's degeneracy. So after the first observation, the last 4 years, there have been many attempts of suggesting ideas how to do it in optics. Now in optics, we're dealing with bosons, they're not fermions. So how do you break scattering, back scattering? So one obvious way is to do it through magnetic fields, which was indeed done by my former student, Marin Soljačić, today a professor at Princeton. But that holds only up to, let's say, megahertz, tens of megahertz, where magnetic effects are not diminishingly small. And then to bring it into the optical domain, there have been many papers proposing it, all of them published in Nature Calibre Science papers, but we did the first experiment, published in Nature 2 months ago. So then I'll show you I'll summarize by one slide just showing that there are many ideas exploring in many directions, some along the lines of one particle, two particles, many along the lines of very many particles, very many photons. And there are many, many questions that are unanswered to this day. And they belong to the category when there is no modeling right now. There's numerics, there's observation, but there's no theory, no model, no understanding as of yet. A lot of it. So I'll start with Anderson localization, because this is more or less how I got into my mindset along these lines. So what is Anderson localization? So Felix Bloch discovered that when you have, everybody here knows this, but never mind, I'll say. So Felix Bloch discovered that when you have a periodic potential, the states that are the allowed energies, in other words, those that do not sit in the forbidden gap, are extended states, all of them, and they are called Bloch waves, and they are periodic. So in other words, the amplitude at infinity is of the same amplitude that is it anywhere else, extended states. And then this was in 1928. But people didn't observe it. People did observe many of the predictions of Felix Bloch, the existence of a band gap, and many other things that come out of that, but not ballistic transport, not transport that is based on the notion that what you have is extended states, superposition of extended states, which means ballistic transport. People observed instead diffusion. So of course, people ask questions in the 30s and 40s and 50s, why is it? And the usual thoughts were twofold. One of them is the reason behind that is coherence, low coherence time. That was the usual excuse. The other one was, well, we have scattering, which means that we have lots of defects. So that means that because of defects, it behaves diffusively. And the thought was that if you increase more and more the density of defects, what will happen to you is the diffusion becomes lower and lower and lower until it is diffusion, still exists, but it's very, very weak. And then came Phil Anderson in 1958 and said, no. Actually, if you have enough scattering, then the material transforms into an insulator. Later on, it's been shown that in one dimension, even a little bit of disorder will lead to localization. The same goes for two dimensions. There's some deep questions around that. It's partly a myth, and I'll be specific in a minute. But in 3D, certainly this is the case. One of the observations that he made is that X states that here, where the potential is periodic, are periodic, of course, but are all extended states. He made the observation that when you introduce some variance in the depth of the potential wells, then all the states become exponentially localized. And transport becomes exponentially localized. In other words, if you want to calculate transport, then the average or the expectation value of the wave packet that undergoes transport becomes exponentially localized. It doesn't reach very far. Okay? For that, he won the Nobel in 1977. So if you read the beginning of his paper, it's called Absence of Diffusion in Certain Random Lattices. And then he says that it is shown that at low enough densities, no diffusion at all can take place. Actually, he meant to say that you do not need huge densities of scattering in order to bring transport to a halt. In other words, that it can happen with low enough densities that are within reach. So you can do experiments. This was his paper. And in the first 10 years, usually I play a game with the audience and ask the audience, how many references do you think that Anderson's paper had in the first 10 years? And I always like to pick on somebody that was a dean. And I ask him specifically. Okay, and I ask him how many, was there anybody here that was a dean? Maybe not, so I will not pick, I'll tell you. So usually people say, well, you know, this paper gave him the Nobel Prize, so chances are it was on the order of hundreds, maybe thousands. Actually, no, the answer is 10, and a large fraction of that self-citations. So I can assure you that at Technion, he would not get tenure. I don't know about at the Hebrew University, chances are he would also not get tenure. That shows you the value of citations. You should judge for quality, not only for citations. And the reason is, explained by Anderson himself. Anderson himself said, on the Nobel podium, that the problem was that in the first 10 years, he himself did not understand the discovery. Rather, he did not understand the discovery, and he had to refer, and there I quote, to the indignity of numerical simulations. Okay? You can find it looking up. Anyway, to me, the reason that it was explained later on, that I understood it, was a paper by my colleague Eric Ackerman in 1985 on weak localization or backscattering. And I will tell you a little bit of the story, but it is not really Anderson localization, just gives a bit of intuition. So the idea is as follows. Let's suppose that we have some medium that is highly scattering medium. So you have multiple scattering events inside. And now you come with an optical, with a wave. You come with a wave like this. Okay, so there is an incident wave, and you look after the wave has done some mean free path inside, some random walk inside, or whatever it did, and then it is emitted on the other side. And you ask yourself, what is the relation between the refracted or scattered wave and the incident wave? And the answer is, because it went inside many, many scattering events, there's no memory. So you would assume that probably you'd expect to have the same amplitude, the same probability of scattering in any direction, irrespective of the input. Well, in optics, we know it's not exactly true. In optics, we are familiar with something called the Lambertian source, but it's also very weak, so it's not uniform. It goes like a cosine, but it's weak enough. And Eric found that it's untrue. Actually, there is one unique direction, which is exactly the direction of incidence. And you have one that goes exactly opposite to it. And the reason for that is, I'll let you ask at the end, please. Don't. Anyway. No, I will give reference. I like to give reference to that, but it is not really explained well. It's buried in the equations. Eric was Reinhard, actually, not Eric. I agree with you. His partner is the one that. But no, it's not Altshuler. I know Altshuler well. We discussed that. It's not Altshuler. There was in 1980 a paper, self-consistent, by Wolfe. That paper is the one that instituted that. But that was too mathematical, and most people did not understand a thing from that paper. And actually, Altshuler hates that paper, as you probably know. Okay. Anyway, so but the point on that is the following. So if that's perfectly fine. It's more than that. I said it as a plenary talk at Clio. You can find it at Clio in my 2011 in front of 1,500 people. It's all recorded on the web, and so far I have no complaint on that. And so it was 2 years ago already. Anyway, but the point is the following. So the point is that if you are looking at just one particular solution when you are the wave going here, then it does mishmash what it does then, and it scatters exactly back. You can do this cycle clockwise or counterclockwise. Okay, if time reversal symmetry is maintained, in other words, no magnetic effects and so forth, then the two waves, the one that goes clockwise, the one that goes counterclockwise, in random scattering in the medium, do the same path, acquire the same phase. So therefore, they will interfere constructively. So there will be a factor of two larger amplitude interference because of this interference of returning. Now, this is for weak localization, just looking at an interface. For Anderson localization means that if I am the wave packet that wants to get localized, so everywhere I go, I will get a factor two larger interference coming back. It does not explain the effect, but it gives some intuition because there's still the open question is why this one interferes with that one. Okay, so that has to be shown, but it gives some idea. So this is why there is Anderson localization, a little bit of the intuition behind it. I have some many interesting stories here that some of them I heard from Phil Anderson, some of them from others, from old times, timers from that time. One thing that I do want to say is that there is some issues and mindsets about dimensionality. So in one dimension, in two dimensions, there is a mindset that says, or the analytic proof, that eventually a little bit of disorder, if you wait long enough time and asymptotic time, everything is localized. That is true only under Anderson's assumption. Number one, what is the assumption? The assumption is that what he did is tight binding, which means that there is some implicit periodicity in the medium, and you play just with the variance. But in physics, that's not the case. There is some scale of resolution. In other words, if you really go for something that a continuous model where you have the scale, so the disorder cannot be smaller as you want. At the minimum, it will be at the scale of one atom, maybe one lattice constant. Now, that means that the disorder the spectrum of disorder is truncated, which means that now we are talking about disorder that is, if the spectrum is truncated, disorder is correlated. What happens with correlated disorder? The whole activity in that area started only after 2008, after the experiments of Elena Spee, where this is what he observed, so he had no choice. And the reason that he observed it is that he made a disorder with laser speckles, which fundamentally are limited in size to diffraction limit. They cannot be smaller than something. So it came from experiments. And because of that, people start to try and understand. Same goes for 2D. In 3D, there is a phase transition. So this is why localization should happen, at least a hint of the intuition. It's not really full, but something. Now let me convince you why in condensed matter there's no Anderson localization at all. Not only that it has not been observed, there's no Anderson localization. There's maybe other versions. Anderson made also two very strong assumptions, two additional assumptions, not only on the spectrum of the disorder. One of them is that the potential, lattice plus disorder, are frozen in time. Okay? That means that you cannot allow them to fluctuate because phonons or whatever you have, the finite temperature effects, will rattle the potential, and it is very easy to show that if you rattle it even a little bit, what will happen, you go back to diffusion. You lose localization. One can say that perhaps today this is a technological obstacle. It's not a fundamental one. Because, okay, today we know how to cool rarefied gas to nanokelvin. We know how to cool solids, not so much, but maybe one day we will know. So maybe one day we will observe them. So the second one is really harder. Many body interactions. Anderson solved for a one particle model, just one electron. If these were bosons, one could say, okay, let's put them sufficiently low density and let's see if we can do business. But electrons are not like that. You put another one, it interacts. It repels from the first, and also they can do spin exchanges. So the interactions kill it. The interactions cause major problems. There are many open questions. To this day, if not Anderson localization, what will happen? So all of this became emphasized only in the late 70s, after the Nobel. In the 70s, after already there were several major papers predicting Anderson localization, there were many, many experimental groups doing experiments, trying to observe it because everybody knew there is a Nobel at stake. And in 1977, there was a Nobel given to Anderson for something that at that time was not observed. I can tell you what was observed. What was observed is that the reduction of transport by hopping, not through bends like the way that he explored, but by hopping from deep defects. And when you put more and more disorder, you can see that it goes down, but not to an insulator. And that's about it. And other than that, it was not observed. So one can ask rightfully how you give a Nobel to something that has, to a prediction that is not observed. My answer is that the one that won it with him, Sir Neville Mott, won it for something that was disproved 5 years later by three experimentalists from Bell Labs and a theorist, Ravin Bhatt, that is today at Princeton. And so if you don't believe me, please Google it right now, Sir Neville Mott, and you see a Nobel laureate whose discovery was disproved. Now, putting the jokes aside, the important part is that both of them discovered new concepts. So never mind the fact this was observed or even that one was disproved. They did so much, so they definitely deserved it. If not for that, this is a nuisance on something else, on the Anderson states, and there are many other things. Going back to Anderson localization, what could be actually very disappointed? There's a beautiful physical phenomenon. You can't observe it. So what do you do? Well, it turns out that Anderson localization is an effect of wave mechanics. It has nothing to do with quantum. In fact, entanglement adds some interesting spice to that, which is not at all obvious, not at all clear. To this day, what happens to entangled states during localization has not been explored experimentally. It's been explored theoretically only and only recently, the last 2 years, by Yaron Zilberberg and by Dimitri Stodolides. And there are some beginning experiments, and that's about it. So really, the way that people thought about it, the way that I posed it just a few minutes ago, it has no entanglement at all. It is a wave mechanic effect. So therefore, it should be observed in practically any classical wave system. Well, the first one that noticed that is Sajib John, that is erroneously counted among the two discoverers of photonic crystals. The real discoverer of that is Eli Ablonovich. And somehow, Sajib John had a paper on localization at the same year in the same journal. But it was not really about photonic crystals. But Sajib John, 1984, wrote a very important paper about Anderson localization of light. The problem is that people like me would never read this paper, and probably people from Anderson localization also will not read this paper. Why? Because it says absorption. Anderson localization has nothing to do with loss or absorption. In fact, quite the opposite. But the person that should have read it did read it, and that person was Phil Anderson, and because of that, he made sure that Sajib John is given an assistant professorship at Princeton. Later on, he didn't get tenure, but it is typical at Princeton. So he shouldn't be, so today he's at Toronto. He did quite a bit of work in the time. So it is actually quite natural to look for localization of flight. There are many, many good reasons. The best one is probably long coherence time, but there are many, many others. Also, it's a natural phenomenon. So what was done? So this is the experiment. This is Ackerman and Maynard about localization. I told you about this. And here there are three experiments. The first one was 97, a group of Ad Lachendijk. And that what they did, they took some kind of a suspension and they launched a laser pulse and they put inside it some scattering center, just dielectric scatterers, okay? And they looked at the output, and what they saw is that the output, given enough density, the output goes exponentially with the density, goes down exponentially with the density of scattering and with the distance. Today, that paper is considered wrong because of absorption. In other words, absorption is also going down exponentially. So what can you say? So of course, the experimentalists made sure that one path in the medium is such that it is much shorter, 10 times shorter than the absorption length. However, when you are looking at multiple paths, let's say 1,000 paths, one path is nothing. So in fact, if you calculate the number of multiple paths, you will see what they observed is absorption. We still cite it because it was pioneering and inspiring. Second one after that was a paper by Azig and Ack's group in the microwaves. He did really good homework. In my opinion, that's the first kosher observation of these effects related to Anderson localization. And he looked at the exponential decay and also looked at the enhanced back scattering. The third one was a paper by Georg Maret from Konstanz that today we refer to it as inconclusive evidence. If you read that paper, you'll see why. At any rate, but even if all of them are kosher, all these experiments were done in a medium that is completely random medium. So in other words, nobody really tried to explore what happens to a lattice plus disorder. So we were set up to do that, and after us, there were quite a few others. I just cited here the important ones. Here after us, Yaron Zilberberg, Yoav Lachini did a beautiful experiment in a 1D lattice. And then after that, Elena Spee did similar things in cold atoms in one dimension. And in parallel to him, back to back, was a paper by Massimo Ingusio in Nature that is also considered not wrong, but irrelevant to Anderson localization. What they showed is really they looked at the phase transition in a quasi-crystal. In a quasi-periodic system, one dimension, there is something that we call the André-Aubry transition, from where all the states are delocalized to all the states are localized. It is, I would say, it's an interesting and nice coincidence of a one-dimensional system. It's not fundamental and it's not universal or anything of that sort. But at that point, because they had no idea about Anderson localization, put it in the same class and the referees were stupid enough. Paper was published back to back with them. By the way, Ingusio has no clue on that. He was just the big boss of 30 people. The one that did the experiment is a guy by the name of Mondugno. He's a very good scientist. He admits himself that he had no clue at that time on Anderson localization, but he still got himself a nice associate professorship because of that paper. In the last 2 years, there were two groups, one of them DiMarco and the other one Elena Spee, that did Anderson localization in three dimensions, and they claim to have observed the I would say, signatures of the transition. I find that both papers are very nice papers. There are experiments now with ultrasound, and there are many, many other areas. So what do we do in optics? So generally speaking, the way we treat it in optics, think about a matrix of waveguides, of optical fibers. So think about a bulk material obeying the same equation as before, and now what you have here is a two-dimensional matrix, 1,000 by 1,000 fibers that are very, very closely spaced to one another, closely spaced so that light can tunnel from one to another, okay? So one can show that if you take the light, a light beam, and launch it into one, what will happen to it? It will undergo ballistic transport. Ballistic transport means that the size of the wave packet will increase in proportion, linearly proportional to the distance of propagation. Just like ballistic transport, if the Schrödinger equation in free space, only there it's in time, okay? Evolution is in time. But then when you start to put disorder, so in other words, you add some disorder to the depth of the potentials, the light wave packet will localize and will never become broad. So the equations are the same equations. As Feynman said, same equations have the same solutions. So if you look at it from the top, let's say this is like my fibers that go like this, and okay, like the fingers, and you launch the light here, the light tunnels to next nearest neighbor, and after some distance, it is distributed all over the output phase. Okay? Now when you put disorder, the light will bounce back and forth, stochastically, and will never become broad. Okay? Now we need to go back to Anderson's conditions. To observe it. First one, that it must be linear, no interactions. With light, it's trivial. All you need to do, reduce the intensity. The light naturally is linear. If you work with a low enough intensity. We need sometimes to work very hard to have nonlinear effects, in other words, to increase the intensity considerably. So that's trivial. Second one is that you need to have the potential disorder in the lattice invariant along z, along in time. So it needs to be here invariant in the propagation direction. So you need to make sure that your disorder is in x and y, but it's uniform along z. Otherwise, no localization. That was the logic. And with this, we set up to do the experiments. And before the experiments, we did the simulations. And what you see here, we say, OK, we launch the light into one waveguide at the input or some given position. And we are looking at after some given enough distance. And we play with the level of disorder. Before that, I need to warn you that this is an expectation value problem. When you do experiments in quantum mechanics, because it is an expectation value problem, a single measurement makes practically no value. You need to do the experiments and to count. And the more states, photons you have, the better accuracy, the better more you can say about your measurement. Otherwise, single measurement carries practically no value. In optics, you need to do it by hand. Okay? In other words, what you need to do is to take the experiment, do it again and again and again, let's say 100 times for the same for level of disorder, then do ensemble averaging. So what you have here is the following. So what you have here is what is the size of the output wave packet after some distance as a function of propagation distance and the function of disorder. Okay, so when you start with a perfect lattice, you see that the wave packet expands linearly with the distance z, ballistic transport. Then you start to increase disorder, so you go down here. At some point, you cross this, the dashed one. Dashed one is where you have diffusion. Diffusion is random walk. So the size of this area within which you can find the particle in a two-dimensional space goes like the square root of time. Okay, same thing here. Now you continue to increase it, and then it becomes disorder becomes stronger and stronger, and until it, and you can see that the wave packet levels off. And after that, it just fluctuates a bit, but never becomes broader. So this is what we are after. Okay. So and then we see if you sit after some distance, propagation distance and look at your output, what you will see, you play with just the level of disorder. What you'll get is that it becomes broad and becomes narrower and narrower and narrower. Okay. So you are looking at it, because it's a finite distance, not infinite time, it crossover from ballistic to diffusive to localization. Again, it's a statistical problem, so you need to take ensemble average over many, many realizations of the disorder. So, but how would you know? You see that the output, you see that as you increase the disorder, the wave packet becomes narrower and narrower. How would you know that you are not in weak diffusion? Maybe you are in weak diffusion, not in localization. The answer is you have to look at the wave packet. This is our great advantage in optics. So in optics, we will see that if we are in the diffusive regime, what you'll see is that your distribution, your wave packet, will look Gaussian. So if you take the logarithm of the ensemble average wave packet, you will see something that looks like a parabola. Whereas if you are in the localization regime, exactly as Anderson predicted, the wave packet will be exponentially localized. So when you take the logarithm, you'll see a cusp, two straight lines. So this is what we are after. So with this, we did an experiment. And the experiments here, which took us 2.5 years, and there are some very good reasons why. And we needed to make the potential, the optical potential, such that it will be stationary or frozen in the direction of propagation. So how would you do it? So back in 2002, 2003, we discovered a way, we invented a way, how to make a photonic crystal in real time, which is exactly suitable for this kind of experiments, where you need to repeat it many, many times. So how do we do it? You take some photosensitive material. And you have a trick. We have a trick how to transform interference pattern, optical interference pattern, into a change, a local change in the refractive index. So think about a hologram. We are like writing a hologram, but not in a plane, not on surface, but throughout the depth, which can be very long. It can be 10 centimeters. Okay. So how do we make a lattice? We take three plane waves. They are symmetrically organized about some particular axis. The interference between them is triangular lattice. And this will induce a triangular lattice that will be the same throughout propagation, throughout the depth of the crystal. And then we add to it speckles, light, pass light through some diffuser, and superimpose them. And you get something that looks, you know, a lattice with disorder. And every time, if you increase the strength of this one, the intensity of this beam, the change, the effect of the disorder on the depth of the potential will become bigger and bigger. So this is how you can test it, what happens when you increase the level of disorder. And how do you do statistical average? You repeat, you move the beam to another place on the diffuser, and you have another experiment. What you have is now another set of experiments under the same statistics. This was the logic. So I will skip this, how do you make it? So this is the experimental system like this. The trick is how to make a disordered beam speckle such that they don't diffract. I will not tell you how. We know today how to make it. And I will show you how the experiment looks like. So you take the beam, you make this kind of disorder. you take a beam that is a conical lens, and in the far field of that you have a ring of light, which is crucial to make disorder that doesn't evolve with Z. And then you put a diffuser here, and then you launch it as one of these lighting beams, and then you send a beam, another beam that is very weak of orthogonal polarization, and you just image it. Okay, so our single experiment is looks like this. So it looks pretty much nothing. And you calculate the effective beam width or the inverse participation ratio from the side, repeat this 100 times, and you find that the inverse participation ratio is a function of the disorder level looks like this. When experimentally sees this, is immediately alarmed because the error bars are huge. So variance is huge. So I was indeed alarmed, but my colleague Shmuel Fishman told me this to be expected. When your every realization, when the localization length or the distance within which you can find the wave packet, the finite distance, is much larger than a single realization, that's what you expect. And indeed, we saw this, which is to be expected, and the effective width goes down as we wanted. And let me show you now how the experiments like this look like. Okay, so when you have a clear, like perfect lattice, and you launch the light, it comes out acquiring the symmetry of the lattice. When you start to make the disorder stronger and stronger, you see it more and more localized. And you take the logarithm of the ensemble average statistical wave packets, you see that here you are in the diffusive regime because it's a parabola, and right here, it looks like exponentially localized. So with that, my students wanted to say, okay, now we did the first, we should send it to nature. And I told them, no, this we could do numerically. This is known. I want something new. And we had something new. And the something new is, first of all, we looked at nonlinearity with disorder. In other words, we did also the first experiment that has looked at localization plus interactions. In this case, we looked at self-focusing, which is attractive interactions in cold atoms, same thing. And we looked at what happens. Okay? And we have shown experimentally and numerically that interactions, at least for some finite range, attractive interactions will enhance localization. So localization will happen earlier. And in doing that, we also discovered a new creature, which is an ensemble average soliton. So we sent it, and then since then, there are many, many other groups, whatever. But let me spend a few minutes talking now, going back a bit, and talking about what happens when you have the disorder evolving with Z. So what was known since David Thouless and Anderson and the gang of four is that when you introduce fluctuations, temporal fluctuations in the Schrödinger equation, you go back to diffusion. And people thought, okay, look, this is to be expected because this was one of the conditions under which Anderson operated. So I wanted to test this. So at the beginning, it came just as we worked so hard to get disorder that is stationary with propagation. So let's now back up a little bit and see what happens if we don't, and let's see how quickly we go to diffusion. And then one day, so we made the potential fluctuate more and more in the evolution direction in Z. And one day, my student Liad comes back and says, Moti, look, we have now, not only we went back to diffusion, we went back now to super diffusion, faster than diffusion. In other words, the wave packet expands more than the square root of time. I said, okay, but it will definitely have to stop at ballistic because light must propagate in a straight line. No, this is a Fermat principle. You know, what more than that? And so he said, well, let's see. So he continued to do experiment to make it fluctuate more and more. And then we found out that it exceeds the ballistic rate, not by a little, by a lot. I told him, Liad, there must be something wrong. Go do numerics. There's no analytics. Go do numerics. So he repeated the numerics, and indeed, the numerics show that we can go a lot faster, 50% faster than ballistic. So what has happened? So I will skip the experimental system, how we do it. I would just want to show you, maybe I'll show you first simulation, okay? So we start with numerics, that shows you the Anderson localized wave packet. Okay, so it looks very, very nice, exponential localized. And now you make it evolve in Z, and what you see that it goes back the beam, the wave packet becomes broader, and it acquires some. Yes, I will say. Okay. But Nadav, don't kick me out of the stage. Huh? So the experiment is like this. We worked, as I said before, we worked very, very hard to make the potential, the disorder, stationary in the propagation direction, which is like time. So what we did, the way that we did that, we made in Fourier space, we made a very narrow ring of light, simply, and on that ring, we put random phase and amplitude. And the reason is that if you are in momentum space, if you are on a ring, if you take wave electromagnetic waves and put them, plane wave, put them on a ring like this, all of them have the same projection on the Z direction. So that's why they will acquire phase at the same rate. Now, if you populate the phase stochastically, you will have speckles, but they will be non-diffracting speckles. They will propagate indefinitely. If you make the thickness of the ring very, very narrow, it will propagate indefinitely it's non-diffracting speckle, the same speckles here and here and here for a very large distance. Okay? So now that this was to make it non-diffracting. Now we want it, because this is what creates the potential. And now that we wanted to make it diffracting, what we did, we made this ring a bit thicker and thicker and thicker. So we make it, gave it some thickness. What that means now is that now you have some characteristic distance after which the speckles change. They will remain at the same statistics, but they become different. So as a result of this now, the wave packet that goes here will not experience any more stationary potential. It will start to see evolving potential. So it is like having something disordered that starts to rattle. Okay? So now you ask what happens. And Anderson and Taule said that you go back to diffusion. And what we saw is mind-boggling. We saw something faster than ballistic. Okay? So this is, if I go to Schrödinger, that's what it means. It's now the potential is changing also in time. Okay? So this is how it looked. So now when we started, when it's really narrow ring, the disorder is spectrum narrow, narrow ring, and we have Anderson localization. Now we start to let it fluctuate a bit, and you see that you go back to diffusion, and indeed it has this bell here that looks a little bit reminiscent of diffusion. And then you let it fluctuate more, and you see it more, become bigger, and then more. But then along the way, we have passed the free diffraction. Free diffraction is ballistic. So we have something faster than ballistic. And this was mind-boggling, so we wanted to understand. We looked at the spectrum. Now, under ballistic propagation, ballistic evolution of a free particle, or particle in a lattice, the spectrum is a conserved quantity. It doesn't change. So obviously, to go something faster than that, we must have acceleration. So when you look at the spectrum, okay, this is momentum space, if you want to get acceleration, you must have some spectral broadening. Spectrum must become bigger and bigger and bigger. Okay? So indeed, this is what happens, and it's a prerequisite for the traveling. So in other words, if you look at the spectrum, let me skip a bit on this. If you look at the spectrum, okay, it's a function of propagation. For ballistic propagation, it's a constant of motion. Localization, the spectrum expands a bit until you acquire some momentum from the disorder, and then it remains stationary again. But faster than ballistic, you have hyperbroadening. You have faster than that. So why does it happen? Okay. So first of all, let's see an experiment. So I've shown you already experiments like this. These are a bit prettier. So this is free diffraction. Localization, you can see the exponentially localized. We get it very easily, very pretty now. Much prettier than the first experiment. And then you can see that hyperbroadening now goes 2.7 times, almost 3 times more than localization, and about factor of 50% more than ballistic. Okay, and this is momentum space, and you see that indeed, when you are in the hypertransport or faster than ballistic regime, momentum space broadens. In other words, really accelerates. What we have for that is numeric. So what we observe? So we observe that we can go faster than ballistic by stochastic acceleration. We also that there must be always spectral broadening. Now, if your disorder has a finite bandwidth, like all physical systems, then the hypertransport effect, at least in one dimension, is finite. The wave packet will expand until it acquires the more or less the width or the spectral width of the disorder, and after that it stops. Please do ask me why people didn't observe it in solid-state physics, even without meaning to observe it, and this, because this answer. Okay, so why does it accelerate at all? You can think about it as energy is deposited by fluctuating potential. Fluctuating potential exerts a force. It's a stochastic force, so it is like increasing the, you know, the somehow the thermal energy. It's not really thermal in any way, but what is the asymptotics? So we know that if the potential is unbound, like in Anderson's model, let's say, if the spectrum is unbound, you will have indefinite hypertransport, and at least in 1D, if you do Newtonian mechanics, you'll end up by having something that looks like where the wave packet will expand faster than ballistic. Okay? But the model that we have now is based on Newtonian mechanics, and it really leaves almost all the questions open. So for example, there are many questions. One of them is, what happens if you are in the Heisenberg time? In quantum mechanics, people don't like Heisenberg time, because they always say it's too short to do anything meaningful. So when you do, you know, the Fermi-Golden rule or anything else, you always like to neglect the Heisenberg time. But in optics, that Heisenberg time is what we call the Raman-Nath regime. We can make it as strong as we want, almost. We can make it extremely strong. And we can have very strong coupling efficiency within that very, very short distance. So maybe there's something here that happens that is really a wave phenomenon and is not a particle phenomenon that will not correspond to particles. So this brought up some very interesting questions, like what happens to correspondence principle. And I can tell you now that at least numerically we have found that we can break the correspondence principle. Niels Bohr's correspondence principle. To this day, there are only two cases known, at least that I know of, that break the correspondence principle. One is Anderson localization, that any energy, as much as you wish, or any high momentum as you wish, or any large quantum numbers, you have Anderson localization, which is a strictly wave phenomenon, and it is not occurring for particles. Particles will do random work. This is one. The other one is quantum chaos. But I don't know of any other thing that violates the correspondence principle. Maybe there is another. Okay. But there is a new one here, apparently, so it seems. Okay. And there are many, many, many other questions. Electromagnetism is, I claim that it's richer than Schrödinger, because we have, the equation is really not first derivative. It has second derivative also in time. Okay. So it is richer, and there are many interesting questions, including the evanescent waves. Can we make evanescent waves that usually carry zero power? Can we make transport of evanescent waves like this, or hypertransport? All of these are open. Now let me spend a couple of minutes maybe on topological insulators. Maybe. So what are topological insulators? Topological insulators were discovered by Kane and Mealy, and the idea is what I told you before. You have some kind of a 2D or 3D space where the bulk is an insulator, and around the edge, there is only transport along the edge. And it's completely scatter-free. How does it scatter free? It is scatter free because there are no states to scatter into. In other words, these are topologically protected states. So the way to think about it, think that you have some potential. You come with a wave packet, and some of it is transmitted, some is reflected. So scatter free, topological protection means that these states don't exist. So you have nothing to scatter into. So for that reason, if you want to think about what is the requirement for a topological insulator to happen, one is that the edge states, you have transport only along the edge states must be in the gap of the bulk. Okay, so you cannot couple from edge states into the bulk. Scatterers will not do it. Or deep inside in the bed, let's say half bend. Okay? The other one is something must break, something must prevent backscattering. So what can prevent backscattering? So as I told you before, my former student, Marin Soljačić from MIT, did that with magnetic fields. So he broke the time reversal symmetry, and what you see here is an experimental picture. This is how his system looks like. It's all in the microwave because you need the geo-optic effects. So the scale is 4 centimeters. And what you see here is really from the experiments comes a wave packet, okay, like this along the edge between a geo-optic photonic crystal and the photonic crystal that is not geo-optic. And then you put some edge, some defect here, comes the edge state and goes around the defect and goes on the other side. Nothing scatters back, nothing scatters into the bulk. That was, this paper was in 2009, and since then people try to think about something, can we bring this to photonics? To bring it to photonics has two issues. Number one is that this is really like the quantum Hall effect, because you need magnetic field. Bring it into photonics, you need to have a mind switch to bring something that comes from the inherent nature of your system. Okay? Putting external field is like the quantum Hall effect. You need something different. That's number one. So the other one is there are actually applications in optics. Everybody that wants to think about optical networks would like them to be scatter-free. Today, there are no scatter-free networks, and people work hard for that. I'm not sure that we can solve this issue, but at least physically, it's interesting. So really, what we need is a conceptual leap akin to Kane and Mealy. This was known. This is the quantum Hall effect, where the backscattering was prevented by magnetic field, which is in photonics was done by Soljačić, before that predicted by Duncan Alden and Princeton, and then brought it into topological insulator, which is what Kane and Mealy did, but they found it, they relied on Kramers degeneracy. But with bosons, we don't have Kramers degeneracy. So what do you do? So I will skip this. So what do we do? So first of all, and the idea again is that you want to have something that sits, edge states are in the gap, and you want something to break the time reversal symmetry. So for this, what we did a photonic lattice like this. We organized it in like honeycombs. So if you look carefully, you see honeycombs here. My group was doing honeycombs already from 2006. Well, we looked at already, we were the first ones to take this graphene physics into systems outside graphene, and we observed the Dirac points and many other things. So this previous slide. So here, it is not enough. But what you want here is that if you launch something, some wave, and then this wave goes like this, you look at it from the top, now there's a defect. Instead of scattering, now you can't scatter. In other words, this will be forbidden. And what will happen is that it will continue straight on. And then we'll arrive to the edge and bend to the other side and go around and around, and not scattering. How we do it? We break reversal symmetry by hand, forcefully, no magnetic fields. So we organized the waveguides, our waveguides here, in the form of a honeycomb. So each one of these goes into the blackboard. So they are all honeycombs. So it means that they are like graphene. So they have Dirac points and everything. What is unique about this is that the edge states sit between two Dirac points, always, or they are in the gap, but there is no gap. Now, every waveguide, we made it to spiral. As you propagate at the same rate, as a result of this, you have something that looks like gauge. As a result of that, you open a gap. Okay, you have opened the gap. And now what you've done, you've induced edge states that go with group velocity for the upper edge with positive group velocity, lower edge with negative group velocity. Mathematically, what will happen, you will end up, after you move to rotating coordinates, you'll get something that looks like this, which is exactly this vector potential that makes the difference. And this is what we have. So if you take our graphene, optical graphene, which is like any graphene solid state, the edge states sit in the gap. And now when you start to make the waveguide spiral, what you have now you've broken the symmetry. You first created a gap. So now there is a real gap. All the edge states are in the gap. And now you have edge states on the top edge that go with positive group velocity and the bottom edge with negative. So with this, I'll show you some examples. So this is what happens when you launch the light here, and it comes out after some distance here. You move it a little bit to the right, it comes out more and more down. Now the edge right here is a huge defect. Light is typically scattered into the bulk and back. So if you don't have this spiraling, it will scatter back. But here it didn't. And maybe the prettiest, this is a nice simulation, maybe I'll just show it for you. Okay. So this is what happens. Okay, so it goes around and around, because everything spirals, it goes to the edge, it bends down. This is crazy if you think about it. Any photonic system will scatter immediately. This is a huge defect at the corner. But it goes down and will go down and around, scatter free. And then I'll show you in a moment experiments how it is scatter free. Okay, so it goes like this now. Okay, so I will skip this one. But here I'll show you what happened. So here we made the same honeycomb, but now cut in a triangle. And here we skipped a waveguide. So now as the light comes from here, it should have been scattered. It comes, this is a huge defect. Yes, it would scatter here or scatter back, but it didn't. Instead, it passed and all the light is here. So I will maybe stop here. This is nonlinear, which is also interesting because nonlinear has interactions in it. What happens is that you create the wave packet, creates, some of you recognize this term in the Hamiltonian, the wave packet creates in the bulk its own topological insulator. And it has in inner and outer edge states, which is beautiful in itself. So instead of conclusions, I don't like to conclude. Conclude means that the field is dead and you can write a book and go and retire. Okay? So there are many, many interesting things to do. And all of them started with this notion that these are experiments. We started with experiments where we knew the answer. But this was not the goal. The goal was to get some idea and from there just to jumpstart new directions that will lead to new theories that are computable. So today we are still working with many photons. But we already start to think about single photons, and there are already some groups. For example, the group of Zilberberg and Christodoulidis, they look at localization with entangled states, which is very interesting. I should say that if I am to look in general about this whole area of quantum simulators, or at the single particle level, a single photon level, atoms seems to always be able to beat us in optics. There are only two cases because the interaction between two atoms is much stronger than the interaction between two photons. Yes, there are some candidates that may bring a home run. For example, Rydberg states. That may be one situation. Maybe metamaterials will come up with something with large enough dipole moment. I don't know. I actually a little bit suspect it because the interactions between two nearby atoms is stronger. But I think it's a fashion. I think it's a trend to look at a single photon. My personal view is that I don't believe that this will reach very, very far. I think in the end, everybody will be interested in many body effects. Many body effects means multiple photons. And then we go back to us. So my bottom line is that I always try to tell my students that, look, the most important discovery is still always beyond the corner. You should look ahead, not back. Thank you.
So we have time for some brief questions. So I have a question about the topological insulator. Can you really solve it in the sense, the analytical sense, to really prove, diagonalize it, and prove that you have the edge states?
Sure. In tight binding, it is practically analytic, almost all the way. In the end, you have to solve a simple equation. And you can really show why they are topologically protected, and you can do more. What I didn't tell you is that the inspiration to our idea came from a young kid by the name of Nathaniel Lindner. Yeah? Okay. This, okay. Nathaniel Lindner and from Erzberg. They were writing, actually Nathaniel Lindner came after Erzberg, but because he submitted to Nature Physics and the referees didn't believe it. But they were submitted about, they submitted about a month before them. So we referenced both. And so in other words, what happens here is the following. One way to prove that you have topological insulators, there are several ways. One of them is to talk about the Chern number. So what these kids suggested is the following. And they said, okay, let us take a material that has valence and conduction. Let us break time reversal symmetry by hand. What does it mean by hand? By modulating in time. You can break time reversal symmetry with magnetic field, but you can also modulate in time. So when you modulate in time, what you can still talk about is semi and pseudo energies, whatever. But let's look at the, so this is known. Let's look at what happens to the band. So when you do that, and you start to modulate, let's say, and you look at what happens to you as a function of frequency. So when you modulate at higher and higher frequency, at some, the bands start to come together. At some point, they merge. When they open up again, and you continue to modulate, when they open up again, they have Chern number of one. You continue to modulate, they'll go apart, and then come back again. They open, they have Chern number two. In other words, Chern number immediately tells you that you are topologically non-trivial, and you can actually calculate what will be the Zach phase, which is what we did, and so on and so forth. In other words, in our system, if you wish, you can think about it as the Berry phase. Berry phase in a plane is typically zero, so here we have pi. So it is really a topological insulator. This is where the inspiration came from Nathaniel's paper. And then there was a group by Fertig and Arovas and Asa Orbach that actually took these ideas and simply suggested, let's do it in graphene. So that's how we picked on the idea. Jonathan Plotnik did that, my student.
Sorry, can you say to what degree you can modulate the refractive index?
Yes, we can go, okay, in the material system that we work today, we can do a modulation that is up to, let's say, several times 10 to the minus 3. And we can model in terms of absolute change in the index. So if the index, let's say, is on the order of 2, let's say 1.5, it's glass. This one was done in glass. So in glass, we can go, let's say, 10 to the minus 3, 10 to the minus 4. And but there are systems to that because we are not, I don't like fancy fabrication. But there are already groups that can do etching in the glass. People do already 3D photonic crystals, so they really know how to drill holes. We don't need it for this. If we want to do it in a 2D system, then in a 2D system, this is sufficient. If you ask me what will happen in a 3D system, my guess is that you will need a much larger modulation, much larger, because now you have not Dirac points, you have whale points. It's a bit more tricky, and you need to really, I don't think you'll need to drill holes, but you need to go much deeper.